Good afternoon. Now I'd like to introduce today's speakers. We have Marian Casanueva and Tony Parsons. Marian is an application marketing manager for Schneider Electric with more than 10 years of experience working in various tenets of electrical distribution, both technical and commercial. Passionate about safety and innovation, she has led exciting new technology developments that are focused on delivering enhancements for people and equipment safety. She's responsible for taking to market the next generation UL and ANSI digital circuit breakers, and most recently, the development of a game changer innovation in arc flash protection. Tony Parsons is the engineering manager for customer projects and services at Schneider Electric. He is a power system engineer with more than 20 years of experience, with emphasis in the areas of computer modeling of power systems, relaying and system protection, power quality and harmonics, and electrical safety. He has authored numerous technical papers on various power system engineering topics and has developed extensive training material for both Schneider Electric employees and clients. Tony currently represents Schneider Electric as a member of the IEEE P1584 Arc Flash Hazard Calculations Working Group. So now let's get started. Marian, over to you.
Thank you, Ellen. So thank you for the opportunity to be here today, at least virtually. We're very excited, and it's a real pleasure to share this presentation with the audience here. So moving on to the general high-level outline of our discussion and presentation today, we will set the stage on safety and provide some stats around the topic. We will introduce our approach, so how the industry approaches safety and how we've been able to evolve to higher levels of control for enhanced personnel safety, and also to reduce the risk for business operations. And then we'll go into details around four categories or four dimensions of safety that we have created or developed in as our approach or Schneider Electric. And we'll give you guys some really nice examples and visuals on these four dimensions. We'll go into details or deep dive with an arc flash use case, so we can take a look at some calculations around some of the advantages or benefits that can come from adopting a safety by design approach. And then we'll give you guys some resources. I believe you guys will receive the link via email, and then open it up for some nice questions, Q&A. Excellent. So let's get started. So when it comes to safety, we've made great strides in the right direction when it comes to keeping workers safe and reducing the risk for business operations. It's actually pretty radical to think that not too long ago, electrical incidents causing injury and sometimes even death were viewed as part of the cost of doing business. As you can see from these statistics or numbers that I'm showing here on the slide, there is still work to be done. So we have some statistics on, you know, the frequency. How often do we have electrical incidents? It happens about 5 to 10 times a day. That rounds up to, if we want to put it into a yearly frame, it comes to around 2,500 incidents a year in the U.S. And 200 of those are actually fatalities. So it does come with a high cost, and also with a high cost and risk for sure. And especially talking in the broader sense of hazards, well, today, I mean, it's not only about, you know, shock, electrocution, arc flash, it's also electrical fires. We have this number here just to give you guys a feel there's around $3 billion of damages per year. And we do have some statistics from insurance companies that say that especially small businesses that are affected by electrical fires, they usually close down business or their doors within the 3 years of having an incident like this within their facility. Our focus today is really to introduce an approach and on how we categorize safety and how we walk you through some examples and demonstrate how most electrical incidents can be avoided, prevented through the right implementation or, you know, the right mix of electrical safety solutions and services. And why is this relevant to this audience here? Well, electricity has long been recognized as a serious workplace hazard. And as contractors or construction workers, you have the challenge, and we empathize with the challenge that that you guys are facing to keep employees safe and reduce exposure to the variety of hazards. And even though, as I already mentioned, we've made good strides, we are seeing a downward trend when it comes to electrical workplace fatalities, you can also see from this chart that the construction workers, the contractors, remain the most at risk of death from electrical incidents. You can also infer here that there's a direct relationship between the risk of injuries and fatalities and also the scope of work done by the contractors. And what I mean by this is as your work scope or the work performed by the typical electrical contractor increases to perform more building or facility maintenance, so does the potential risk. The potential risk also increases with that. Employers have to protect their workers and also work a way to improve their bottom line by implementing the right safety strategies, just to reduce the chances and just the exposure to these types of occurrences. Now I'm just going to walk you through our approach. So how, and this is going to be more of a twofold. So what are some of the advances that we see in the market or in the industry through codes and standards? And also how we as an electrical manufacturer come in and help support, you know, furthering that So as I already mentioned, the threat of electrical hazards has long been recognized in the market, especially when we're talking about shock, electrocution. And we've made, you know, some really fairly good advances by incorporating or recognizing also arc flash and arc blast in the last few years. We have OSHA, the Occupational Safety and Health Administration. They come in and enforce the electrical workplace safety standards, and these are outlined in the NFPA 70E, which is the standard for electrical safety in the workplace. And really what the NFPA 70E is requiring is just, and this is just from a basic compliance perspective, it requires the assessment and implementation of strategies to reduce and control the electrical hazards. And it provides tools to do that. Here you see our version of the hierarchy of controls, which is the core occupational safety and health approach for preventing injuries and fatalities. And this was adopted in 2017 by the NFPA 70. And it gives you or engineers and facility managers a way to determine and prioritize which methods are best to ensure protection. But and this is just kind of our own perspective. You know, a lot of this is very good advancements in the right, you know, in the right, we're on the right track, but it's easier said than done. And we need to continue the journey to raise awareness and implement higher levels of safety controls. And that's where our four dimensions come in. We have taken an approach or leading a way to address engineering controls and develop, you know, a simplified way to categorize and approach the different options that are available out there, really understanding their benefits and or trade-offs, and helping you know, the different customers out there select one over the other or do the right selection, understanding, you know, more of the big picture and how it impacts, especially through the full life cycle of a project. We want to help you through the four dimensions, really, to navigate what we believe is a complex technology landscape. As you can see here, the application of the four dimensions is also key to build more of a comprehensive and holistic strategy. And just Tony, my peer, who's he's going to give you guys examples and go more in depth in each of these four dimensions. But high level, there's four dimensions. We have reduction, avoidance, prevention, and containment. Reducing is all about lowering the electrical hazard level. For example, when it comes to arc flash, energy exposure can be reduced by just lowering or going to faster clearance times in protection devices or circuit breakers, to be more specific. There's the avoid, which is a way just to isolate personnel from the vicinity or the proximity of the hazard, but the hazard in this particular case remains unaffected. It remains unchanged. There's a preventative aspect, which is all about reducing the likelihood, and there's definitely there's different avenues to do that, and especially with new innovations that are coming to the market. There's of course the containment, which has been a good resource from, you know, historical norms. It effectively contains and redirects the electrical hazard and its byproducts away from personnel. So now I'm going to hand it over to you, Tony, and you can take the audience through the journey of the four dimensions and, give us more details around application and examples.
Oops. All right. Thank you, Marian. And thank you, everybody, for joining us this afternoon. Yeah, what we are going to do in the second part of this presentation is just go into some more detail on each of these four dimensions that Marian just introduced. I will tell you that they were originally developed as a way for us to categorize arc flash solutions. Arc flash hazards are something that has gained a lot of interest in the industry in recent years, and that's resulted in vendors coming up with a lot of different innovative solutions, different types of engineering controls, as it would fit in on the NFPA hierarchy of controls that Marian showed earlier. Lots of things that can help us address the hazard. But what we've learned over the years is that it can be very difficult, particularly if you're not, you know, involved in this day-to-day, it can be very difficult to sort out which of those solutions are really the most effective and the most useful in any given situation. But we found that if we could categorize them and look at different, you know, common characteristics of those categories or dimensions of safety, as we're calling them here, then it really did help us in the evaluation process. You know, the categorization helps us to look at positives and negatives of each dimension. It gives us ideas about what you need to know about limitations or gaps in any given solution, because they're all going to have their good points. They're all going to have the points where they fall a little bit short. You know, the way we explain it sometimes is that you need to know what a given type of solution does, but you also need to know, maybe just as importantly, what it doesn't do in order to make the right decisions. You know, if you're an engineer writing specifications for equipment, if you're a contractor helping with value engineering, you know, how can you actually add value around safety? So those four dimensions, what I'm going to do is give examples of each one, talk about how they help, and not just Arc Flash. We will touch on Arc Flash, but I'll give you some other examples where I can and where it makes sense. The first one, though, we'll start off with reduction solutions. Now, the goal of these would be quite simply to reduce the potential severity of the hazard, whatever the hazard is. Now, in a lot of cases, the way to do that is simply to act quickly, and that's why we say that speed is the key to reducing the threat. Now, I'll give you a warning. I'm going to use some real technical terms here. When bad things happen, the faster you make the bad things stop, the better off you are. Speed is the key. Let's reduce that hazard. Examples, you know, we got a few here. A non-electrical one, fire safety. You know, I mean, think about sprinkler systems that you see in buildings all over the place. The goal with those is obvious, right? You keep the fire from reaching its full potential. And when that happens, you want to act quickly, right? You don't sit around and say, well, I guess let's wait and see if this fire is really going to be a bad one or not before we decide to do something. No, you want to get that thing out as quickly as you can in order to protect people, protect property, keep your building from burning down, whatever the case would be. We can do the same thing with electrical hazards, you know, with electrical shock. I imagine many of you are already familiar with this, the one that we got there in the middle of the GFCI, ground fault circuit interrupter. Of course, that's intended to basically provide ground fault protection for people. And one of the ways that it does that is that it acts very fast. I mean, trips in the matter of milliseconds if it's detecting leakage current from some sort of connection to ground or connection where you don't want the current to be flowing. And it's proven over the years, GFCI have been proven to be very effective. I was looking at some statistics yesterday from the Consumer Product Safety Council, and they had, you know, kind of a document that quoted an earlier UL study. But they were saying that GFCI is between 80 and 95% effective at preventing death from electrocution. Again, one of the main ways that it does it simply limits or reduces the amount of exposure. With Arc Flash, a number of solutions out there, probably the number one on a lot of people's mind is some variety of the Arc Flash maintenance switch. At Snyder, we call ours the ERMS, energy reducing maintenance switch. Whatever you call it, they've got similar functionalities. What these switches are generally intended to do, and I've got a picture of one over there in kind of that far right picture. It's a switch that can be turned to a maintenance mode whenever somebody is working in the piece of equipment that's fed by the circuit breaker or relay that the maintenance switch is attached to. So, you know, say a worker has to go and do some troubleshooting. He's got to do some voltage testing in a motor starter that's downstream of that switch. He turns it to maintenance mode first. When it's in maintenance mode, the settings of that circuit breaker are temporarily modified so that they'll trip faster than they otherwise might if there's a fault detected. So if the, you know, the worker gets leads crossed with his voltmeter, whatever creates an arc flash event, you're talking about tripping in, you know, 25 to 50 milliseconds rather than potentially half a second or more. So if you can do that, you know, you just reduce the amount of heat energy that's released in an arc flash event by a factor of 10x or maybe even higher. So, you know, certainly a very clear benefit that we can get from that. Now, the maintenance switch is not the only arc flash solution that's out there. Certainly for the other types of hazards, not the only solution as well. Again, there have been a lot of innovations around these things in recent years. One of the things that we've seen, particularly with arc flash solutions, is that these reduction solutions often seem to be the first ones and maybe the only ones that are considered. And that's fine, but we're going to keep in mind a couple of things. One is that there is no solutions that is without its issues or holes in the protections that it provides. You know, with sprinklers, you got to think about, hey, you know, is a water sprinkler appropriate? Do I have to use some of the material if water damage could cause almost as much of an issue as the fire? GFCIs, you know, sometimes those can be an issue if it results in nuisance tripping of equipment. In my own house, you know, I've done like so many others have done. We got a new refrigerator a few years ago, so we took our old one, put it out in the garage. In the garage, it's fed from a GFCI protected circuit. And so every few months, that thing may trip off. And, you know, the family's just kind of used to, if we go out in the garage, we don't hear the hum. We know that we got to, you know, we have to go push the button. In my case, it's not a big deal. You know, if the refrigerator's out for a couple hours and my Dr. Pepper's not as cold as I would like it to be, but there may be other situations where that's more of a concern. And we see that at times with the, you know, fast acting circuit breakers or relays or whatever for arc flash protection, particularly if you've got a system where selective coordination is a big deal. You know, the way that we usually get coordination in a system is to use longer time delays on protected devices that are closer to the utility source. Long time delays can help improve coordination. That's kind of the opposite, a reduction solution. So there's always going to be trade-offs, which is one of the reasons it's important to remember that there are the other dimensions of safety as well, not just this reduction that we can apply. So the next one we want to talk about is avoidance. Basically, just simply keeping employees out of harm's way. You know, maybe there are times where we can't reduce the hazard as much as we like, but if we avoid it, it may provide a similar level of risk reduction for workers. And, you know, there are tons of examples of this as well. You know, in the non-electrical world, we do this kind of thing all the time. You simply put up a fence around something that you don't want people getting into. In many cases, you know, you don't want them getting into it for their own good. Very simple, but in a lot of cases, fairly effective. We've got in our list here the first one, remote operation, and this is particularly helpful when it comes to arc flash hazards. You know, that can include, you know, remote opening and closing of devices, but also remote racking of circuit breakers. The picture on the far right here is a remote racking control. So you've got a circuit breaker or a starter or whatever that has to be inserted into the bus before it's engaged and can feed a load. You know, traditionally, the way that you've done that is stand right in front of it and the electrician turns a crank until it makes contact. Much better if you can stand, you know, 20, 30 feet away and do that, because there are a number of documented cases of you know, people, you know, just equipment failures or other issues that create arc flash events when equipment is racked in or racked out. So certainly a big, you know, big potential benefit there. The one in the middle, the AVT, is something that's relatively new. Absence of voltage tester is what that means if you're not familiar with it. This is a device that's designed to do the same live voltage test that's required as part of a lockout tagout process. And this can be a good deal. You know, it's a device that allows you to avoid having to open up doors or covers on the equipment. And so if you don't have to physically get in there with a voltmeter to do that test as part of your lockout tagout, again, you've reduced the exposure. Maybe we avoid the hazard in that way. And then we talked about sensors. What kind of sensors? Well, you know, thermal sensors, humidity sensors, partial discharge sensors. Probably the most commonly performed act of electrical maintenance in this country is infrared scans, thermographic scans, where you go in and look for hotspots in your equipment to indicate that there are loose connections or you know, potentially other problems brewing in the equipment. But how's it traditionally done? You have to remove covers from equipment so that you can get access to the energized parts behind them, and then a guy stands there with an infrared camera and takes a picture. Well, we used to point to infrared windows as a way to reduce shock and arc flash exposure around equipment so that you can do your infrared scan just looking through the window rather than, you know, pulling the covers off. And that's still a valid solution, but the industry has you know, continued to innovate, and you know, there are now embedded thermal sensors, embedded humidity sensors, a number of things that not only give you much of the same information, but they can do it continually, you know, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year, rather than just on that once or twice a year when the guy with the infrared camera is there. So avoidance solutions are great. There's a number of those out there. What are the drawbacks? You know, unlike those reduction solutions that we talked about a minute ago, these avoidance solutions are not really addressing the underlying hazard. We're just trying to keep people out of the way. You know, we're not actually engineering it out. So, you know, on an arc flash standpoint, if we talk about remote racking on a piece of gear, you know, the obviously the energy level on the arc flash label on the gear doesn't change. And so, again, I said, you know, some people are, you know, kind of stop and end their search with reduction solutions. Well, if your goal is to get that number down, then that makes sense. Avoidance may not do that for you. But at least the second thing, you know, at least with these electrical avoidance solutions that we've talked about, these things tend to be task specific. You know, that that automatic voltage tester, the AVT, is great, but it doesn't help me operate my breaker. An infrared window or a thermal sensor doesn't help me during lockout tackout. So, you know, part of what you may need to do if you're looking at these solutions is just kind of ask yourself, okay, what is it that folks are doing? What is it that my people are doing around the gear where they're going to be exposed to hazards? And what's out there to help me avoid those types of exposure? These avoidance solutions are really good in certain cases where reducing or, you know, otherwise eliminating the hazard would be cost prohibitive or impractical for some reason, but they may only be part of the puzzle. Even so, certainly no reason to overlook them because they can be very effective. But maybe not as effective as our next one. The next category of solutions we'll talk about is prevention. And we're talking about prevention here mainly in the context of electrical faults in power distribution equipment. But we are going to go through a couple of aspects of this. First, prevention through maintenance, and then prevention through design. And maintenance, yeah. I mean, we make sure things are in a proper operating state. We're also trying to identify things that need to be fixed, and then ideally fixing them before things really do go south. One of the things that has changed in this area in recent years is the availability of data to help with planning of maintenance activities or identifying conditions where you may need to go do some maintenance and repairs. We already talked about the thermal sensors, you know, the humidity sensors, partial discharge sensors, looking for, you know, a potential or incipient breakdown of insulation in equipment. There are online gas monitoring devices for oil-filled transformers, looking at dissolved gases in the transformer as an indication of you know, something building inside there that could ultimately cause a, you know, pretty significant downtime. And this is not just, you know, theoretical. It's not just on the drawing board. We've got, you know, pictures there on the right of actual thermal sensors installed in the equipment. We had a colleague had done a blog post a little while back about a Facebook data center in Sweden that was using continuous thermal monitoring on busways in the facility to help avoid the risk of arc flash or other failures by providing early alerts of potential thermal issues. And that's the ultimate goal with this. You know, maintenance, periodic maintenance is great. If we could get early warnings and act on those warnings, it's even better. One of the questions with this, or one of the challenges, is how do you sort through all the data? You know, there's one of the buzzwords that's out there in a lot of different areas in recent years, machine learning. You probably heard about this. You know, if you can filter all this data through some computer somewhere, that system or a system like that can be very effective at sorting through all the information in order to find that proverbial needle in the haystack, right? We've got thermal sensors located at different points through different portions of our gear. You've got, you know, 99 out of 100 of them, they're just fine. The system, the expert system, finds that 100th one where you've got the issue. Those systems, you know, to some extent, I think are still under development, maybe not 100% in place yet, but at least with Snyder, we've been working to develop these things under what's called our EcoStruxure platform, and have tried to pair, you know, develop some of these algorithms, pair them also with people who review information. It can help change maintenance practices, but you don't have to have something like that. I mean, it can be just as simple as bringing this into, you know, to a computer in the maintenance manager's office and you know, periodically checking things to make sure that all seems to be going well. Lots of different ways to take advantage of this kind of thing. The second part of prevention is really prevention by design. True prevention really begins with safety by design. You know, that's something that's been a buzzword in the electrical safety community in recent years, the idea being that electrical safety is one of those things that ought to be considered as a primary design criteria in either building equipment or systems. You know, consider it alongside things like reliability or cost or footprint or efficiency. You know, in my experience, at least with arc flash, that is generally not happening. More often than not, the typical path is that a system gets designed and installed same way that the last five systems were designed and installed. And then only, you know, sometimes only after it's installed and up and running and somebody does an arc flash analysis and that's complete, and then we find the hot spots in the system. That's the point where, you know, safety really becomes a priority. And it's unfortunate because in a lot of cases, those hot spots, if you will, could have been eliminated with a little bit better planning or a little bit more purposeful designing for safety up front. That's system design. Designing for safety also finds its way into product design as well. It doesn't seem like much of an innovation today, but back in 1907, that was when the Detroit Fuse and Manufacturing Company at that point, they introduced the enclosed safety switch to the market. Of course, that Detroit Fuse and Manufacturing Company became Squared E, which was later acquired by Schneider Electric. So we've got, you know, we feel like we've got a history of looking for these kind of advances along with, you know, with other partners in the industry. The innovations don't always seem to happen as quickly in power distribution equipment as in some other fields, but they do happen. And my own impression is that, at least in recent years, the innovation is speeding up in the industry, not slowing down. You know, the picture on the right here shows an example of shielded, solid, insulated medium voltage switchgear, which is medium voltage switchgear where there really are no exposed parts inside. Bus bars and connections are shielded and insulated with a with material that essentially eliminates that the shock hazard inside. Much harder to ignite an arc or find a place to be shocked if you're working inside that equipment. I think long-term prevention is where the industry is going. It probably won't happen in my lifetime, but eventually we're going to engineer out most of the potential hazards for electrical equipment. So, you know, certainly something to look forward to. Pros and cons with prevention. You know, one of the main positives for this, at least in my estimation, is that it is a proactive solution. We talked about reduction earlier. We talked about avoidance earlier. Both of those things really only help you if there is an event, right? Those reduction solutions in particular are only reactive by nature. You only trip a breaker, you only operate a relay or whatever if there is already something bad that's happening. Generally in a building, you wouldn't turn on the sprinkler system because there might be a fire. If we can truly prevent those hazards, those occurrences from happening, we've kind of gone one better from this. The cons, one of the challenges with these type of solutions is how do you really quantify these effects? You know, we're trying to prevent, breakdowns. We're trying to prevent faults. We're trying to prevent arc flash events through proper maintenance. Well, you know, maintained gear is certainly better than the other kind, but then there's still a potential hazard that you may face if that, you know, if that is, if people are working around that equipment. You're reducing the likelihood of occurrence, which is important in a safety evaluation, but it's just a challenge to measure this. Again, not a reason that, that we need to overlook this or ignore this, but something to be aware of, again, when you're trying to quantify or when you're trying to try to look at the different solutions that may be available. Last category, containment. When it is too late to prevent, you can look at containing the hazard. And in this one in particular, we're going to talk about this, with electrical hazards around arc flash events. This is not the only case where, containment really kind of comes into play. Another, thing with electrical is, you may have to install transformers in a vault if it's oil-filled transformer inside a building to make sure that oil is contained if there's if there's a leak. I was driving down the highway the other day here in Texas, and one of the things that struck me was how the barriers that they put down the middle of the highways kind of fit into this as well. I don't know if they're doing this necessarily across the country, but in Texas, if there is a divided highway with, kind of a grassy median down the middle, in a lot of cases, what they're doing is putting in, poles with, wires strung across them. It's kind of like a fence. Apparently what they're intended to do is reduce the chances of a head-on collision. You know, if somebody's driving, for example, driving south on the highway, they lose control of their vehicle for whatever reason, and they start to cross over the middle of the highway. Well, those wires, that fence, keeps them from going on into oncoming traffic, when, of course, you can have a head-on collision with very serious consequences. So containment can work in highway safety. Containment, I was trying to think about how that applies to electrical shock. I was thinking in particular about maybe finger-safe terminals, things like that. I would tend to put those in prevention or avoidance first. But that's okay. You know, nobody said that all four dimensions here had to be applicable to every possible facet of safety. But containment with arc flash events is a big deal. Arc resistant switchgear is kind of the classic case of containment where arc flash is concerned. And we've got a couple of examples of that on this slide. On the left, we've got a low voltage motor control center, and I've kind of got two pictures shown here on the right hand side. We've got one that has an arc block line side arc isolation module installed, basically our name for a cable vault on the line side of the main circuit breaker that actually does several things, but containment of the fault is certainly one of those. Compare that to the picture on the far left where that same motor control center is under test and arc flash event is ignited there on the main. Not very well contained in that case. So, certainly I know which one I'd rather be standing in front of if things did go bad. On the right-hand side, we've got, a picture of arc-resistant low-voltage switchgear. It's inside those MCCs. It's just a portion of the equipment that's really kind of doing the containment, but you can get it for entire equipment lineups as well. What this equipment is intended to do is contain and redirect that big fireball, the gases, the energy, the molten little copper droplets or whatever that can be produced during an arcing fault. And when they do so, protect the worker who's standing out in front of that gear. And so Marian tells you we're going to have a case study around this. And this is where we're coming to this with arc flash mitigation and containment, really some other aspects of it as well. But containment can certainly be important when you're looking at arc flash protection in a given piece of equipment. Here, I've got an example on the left-hand side of a portion of a one-line diagram of a utility source feeding a transformer that feeds a low-voltage switchboard with a main breaker. And what we've got shown there in red and in green are two different zones of protection. We've got that shown on the same, kind of the same way on the right-hand side, kind of the equipment elevation. And so, zone one is the zone that's ahead of the main breaker in the system. It's on the line side of the main. If you were doing voltage testing, for example, on the line side terminals of the main breaker and there was a fault, the protection for that zone is the utility fuse. Utility fuse generally isn't going to be sized to protect workers inside the customer plant. And so we've got a relatively high arc flash level at that point. The values are shown there in the upper right. 15.6 calories is actually not terrible in this case, but it can be, it's much more than the load side of the main, 1.6 calories where we've got our main breaker tripping to clear the fault. Question is, when are you exposed to what? We talked about, maybe doing voltage measurements on the line side of the main, and clearly you're in zone one. If you were doing voltage measurements at the load side terminals, those bottom terminals of the main breaker instead, well, even though technically you're in zone two, electrically speaking, based on the way a switchboard is typically built, there's not a barrier, there's not, an isolated compartment around that zone one, and so you're still going to be exposed to that higher energy as well. And even if you're doing something over in the right-hand section, the construction of the equipment matters. A low-voltage switchboard may not be barriered off with isolated compartments, so again, you're in zone two, but quite possibly still have that exposure to the zone one energy. What we need to do is isolate zone one so what happens there stays there. And that's where safety by design comes into again. We don't have time to go into full details on the line side arc isolation module, but some of the key features you can see on the right hand side there are barriers there in between phases and from phase to ground. Inside what is tested to prove that it is an arc-resistant enclosure. So we've got kind of a combination of solutions that are coming in there. Prevention, because that, there are no exposed parts in the module when it's fully installed. You can't accidentally drop a wrench or a screwdriver into energized bus. We've got some reduction going on because one of the things that happens, those barriers tend to stretch out the arc. If an arc does somehow get ignited, they stretch it out, and that results in an arc that will extinguish itself and do so very quickly. And then containment, because that outer shell is tested to IEEE standard C37.20.7 for arc-resistant enclosures. Three of the four dimensions of safety, the prevention, reduction, and containment in one type of module that's engineered to provide some additional level of safety. If you want to go 4 for 4, you can add thermal sensors inside the module so you don't have to remove the covers to do infrared scans, and there's your avoidance on top of everything else. We show that not because we're trying to turn this into a sales pitch or anything, but I really do believe this gives us a good example of incorporating those different dimensions of safety into safety by design for a given piece of distribution equipment. Are we going to see more designs like that in the future? I don't know. I certainly hope so. And I hope that with looking at these things, you got a little bit better idea of the types of things that can be done, the types of things that we can look for, the types of solutions that can be considered when we're trying to design safety into a system. With that, we're getting close to the end, but one more thing we said we're going to look at before we brought this to a close. What about return on investment? Because, let's face it, we're talking about these engineering controls, and those are, for the most part, enhancements over standard designs. And with enhanced features come enhanced costs, right? How big of an impact is it, really? And is there some return on the investment? Admittedly, this is a difficult evaluation. The results kind of vary depending on some of the assumptions that you make, but at least we'll go through one example here to give you an idea of how you might go about approaching this kind of thing. If we look at it in terms of total cost of ownership, we have that equipment with line-side arc isolation, for example, that low voltage MCC, and then without the line-side arc isolation. So we got equipment costs that could be considered, installation and commissioning, maintenance and operation, and then what are the costs that are associated with an arc flash event if one were to occur. Well, equipment cost, that arc isolation module may add 10% to the total compared to a standard design. The installation and commissioning really doesn't change a whole lot. You've got a couple of additional covers to bolt on, but, not moving the needle a tremendous amount. Maintenance and operations, periodic shutdowns to check, check the tightness of connections, do your infrared scans, breaker testing. If you're doing maintenance or doing troubleshooting when the equipment is live, you got PPE for workers to consider. But again, fairly close to even between the two. So it's a big deal with the big change with the red arrow. Well, if you do have an arc flash in zone one, with that line-side isolation module, you're talking about what ought to be a pretty rapid return to service. The equipment would have to be taken out of service, which is typical anytime there is a fault, taken out so that it can be inspected just to see what did go wrong and to do some cleanup. You want to get the soot and stuff out of that module. But the overall damage should be minimized. In fact, we've even had some internal discussions about would you even know if there was a fault and it self-cleared and the equipment kept on running. It should be a relatively short path in order to get back up and running. That's why we say hours to days for return to service. In a standard MCC, it's going to be longer. You've got a much more significant cleanup. You're possibly looking at replacing sections or at least sections of bus. If they're burned too badly, maybe replacing a breaker. What's the lead time on those things? It says here weeks to months. Months certainly would be extreme, but it's not hard to imagine that the time is going to be longer than with that isolation module in place. So the costs for repair are more significant. Costs for downtime are going to be more significant as well. Again, that's where some of your assumptions comes in. What is the cost of downtime in a given facility? The final tally would depend on the assumptions you use for the calculations, but even though the equipment costs may be a little higher up front, when you look at total cost, there's no contest, right? This is before we even get into potential cost of injury to personnel who might have been unfortunate enough to be caught up in that incident. So if you're looking at return on investment for investing in safety, putting numbers to it can be a challenge. It's not as easy to calculate the ROI for that as it is for, upgrading to a more efficient motor or something like that. But there are resources out there. Go to your favorite search engine, type in safety return on investment, and there are a number of resources out there that will give you a good start in looking at it from this aspect. We do have additional resources on safety solutions in general. The slide here says click on the link below. Actually, that's what Marion was talking about earlier that will be emailed out to you. We're going to have a link to a safety library that has a number of additional resources that you may care to look at and get a little bit more information. Well, again, we hope we've shared some useful stuff for you and that you'll
we certainly encourage you to look at our other material that we've got put together on these topics as well.